Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be talking about the submandibular gland itself. So this will include actually where the submandibular gland is located and what is its function. Additionally, how does the secretions of the submandibular gland get into the actual oral cavity? So remember, this is an exocrine gland, so it is going to have a duct associated with it. Anytime you have an exocrine, think duct. All right, so much of what we have seen thus far of the submandibular gland has been the superficial part, and you can see that it is the largest part of the submandibular gland. It's going to be located in that submandibular triangle, posterior inferior to the mandible. But this superficial part is continuous around the border of the mylohyoid muscle, one of those suprahyoid muscles, the one that's going to be the floor of the mouth, with the deep part of the submandibular gland, which you can see is located in the sublingual space. So that sublingual space is located between the oral cavity proper and the mylohyoid muscle. So there's a bit of that deep part here. The saliva produced by the submandibular gland does not have to travel as far as the saliva from the parotid gland does. This duct, which is referred to as the submandibular, or clinically often you'll hear it referred to as Wharton's duct, travels from the deep part of the submandibular gland to the sublingual caruncle. So not the submandibular caruncle, it's the sublingual caruncle. That's something that always has given me a little bit of a problem in terms of that name. All right, so you will see the two caruncles. I'm going to kind of try to circle them without blocking them. So the two caruncles are on either side of the lingual frenulum, and medial to the sublingual folds. And these sublingual folds are going to be elevations, so you can see that they're going to be a little bit higher in terms of that, caused by the deep sublingual glands as well as the submandibular ducts. So it's going to be these two small little areas that will allow for the saliva for the submandibular gland to move into the oral cavity region. I want to introduce, while we are here, an important anatomic relationship between the submandibular duct, which I am outlining right here, and the lingual nerve. That lingual nerve, if you recall from other videos, is going to be a branch of V3. And we like to say that the lingual nerve cradles the submandibular duct for a little bit of its expanse. So you can see how that submandibular duct is going superficial to, whereas the lingual nerve will kind of dive underneath and cradle the submandibular duct. And we'll talk about this relationship again in the oral cavity session, but since we were here, I wanted to go ahead and mention it. And you can really see the expanse or the length of the submandibular duct in this image. So certainly comparatively shorter than what you have with the parotid duct. All right, so question answer time. The question is, which nerve passes deep to the submandibular or Wharton's duct in the oral cavity? Is it auriculotemporal nerve, B, the facial nerve, C, hypoglossal nerve, or D, the lingual nerve? So we just reviewed this, so hopefully it is fresh in your mind that the correct answer is D, the lingual nerve. Now, for not actual bonus points, what does the lingual nerve do? This was covered in another video, so this is kind of I'm throwing a curveball here. But think about it, what does the lingual nerve do? What is it going to innervate? It is going to provide general sensory innervation for the tongue anterior to the valate papillae. So importantly though, it also is going to have fibers of the chorda tympani that have preganglionic parasympathetic fibers that hitchhike on it to get to the submandibular ganglion. So the lingual nerve is important in the innervation pathway for the submandibular gland. So it's not the source of the innervation, but it is part of that pathway. All right, so that was fun. Make sure to review and reach out if you have any questions, and have a great day.